Welcome to Last Few Decades Tonight. We're here on Spaceship Earth, you know, that ginormous rock you've been riding on as it circles the nearby ball of blazing hydrogen and helium we call the sun. No, not Disney World Spaceship Earth, and definitely not the Death Star version. How about just the real thing? Keep going. There we go. So, Earth. Let's just call it a spaceship, right? Since it literally is one, and a pretty good one, too. If you're an astronomer searching outer space for an ideal exoplanet to visit, it's basically your wildest dream. Plenty of water? Check. Great air to breathe? Check. Lovely temperatures? Check. Variety of species? Check. Okay. Check. All right, that guy, even him. We'll have you know, by the way, that is a star-nosed mole, and he's got over 100,000 nerve fibers on that proboscis right there, so he's very sensitive. But wait, really, see, this used to be our planet. Our main story tonight is about how we took over the spaceship controls, like some kind of crazed, overgrown baby, and now we're twisting every dial in sight. How our beloved spaceship Earth is being transformed into a new addition where the atmosphere is setting us on fire and we're on the verge of spinning out of control. Or, how to put it in the delicate terms of Jennifer Lawrence's character in one of the most successful climate allegory films so far.
We're all 100% for sure gonna die!
Oh, sure. Sorry, this is academia, right? Respectable intellectuals hear a scientist like Kate getting so emotional and things get quiet quick.
Is she always like that?
So right, more somber tones now. Let's not lose the anchors. We're just going to watch a few film clips and discuss a wee bit of a temperature problem we're having down here since we're putting all of these CO2 gases and CH4 gases and N2O and CFCs and HFCCs, ABCDs, and anyway, they're making our normal greenhouse effect awful. And we really can't afford that. It's throwing this extra blanket onto the atmosphere, holding in way too much of that heat. Relax, though. We're going to play the science on easy level here. No physics you need Calc 3 to be able to understand. Let me just launch us with this first of 10 basic points. Most people have a hard time grasping just how precarious our situation really is. This isn't actually a controversy, not among scientists. There are people who want you to think it is. But that number you might have heard when my historians of science friends were being super cautious that only 97% of credible scientists agree that it's real, it's us, and it's serious, as if there were just three heroic scientists standing up boldly, or maybe sitting at the table, fighting diligently, surrounded by 97 peers, but heroically still questioning the whole paradigm. No, it's 100%. Every single study that's ever been published in any real scientific journal that seemed to cast doubt on greenhouse gas emissions causing almost all of our global heating has been exposed as mistaken, or more bluntly, written by someone paid gaboodles of money by big oil to very obviously cherry pick their numbers. Is there uncertainty in science? Absolutely. But legit doubt about whether our species, particularly a small, very wealthy subset, has been having too many drunken parties on the bridge? No siree, that is us. Since I was a kid in the 1980s, our scientists have been patiently explaining this to us. Lately, they've been pounding at our doors, even locking themselves to bank doors, trying to get our attention. Their message is that our civilization's basic parameters are not sustainable. See, the more scientists have to warn us, the more likely they are to come back a couple years later to apologize. Actually, we've melted the poles even faster than expected. The problem is that we're not listening. Or we've listened with one ear, distractedly. Sort of like, let me put on my very serious face here. Well, that's awful. I just don't get it. Why are people so stupid? it's so depressing, man. But 2 hours later, we've forgotten the whole thing. Or if we're a really special kind of human being, we go after the scientists with messages like these, and I'll warn you, these are disturbing.
You're an effing terrorist. You and your colleagues ought to be shot, quartered, and fed to the pigs along with your whole damn families. How come no one has beat the living piss out of you yet? I was hoping I would see the news and you committed suicide.
You stupid bitch. I would like to see you convicted and beheaded by guillotine in the public square. If you have a child, then women in the future will be even more leery of lying to get ahead when they see your baby crying next to the guillotine. Sometimes it's one a week. Sometimes when your email address gets posted online at Miranda's website, it's 200 or more in a day.
Yeah, that's awful. I trust it's not how any of us are responding, but I do want to point out a couple of pitfalls that most of us are susceptible to. We can't afford either cold cynicism or cruel optimism. We need rational, defiant hope. Here's the thing. If one person looks at our climate situation full of cold cynicism, saying, we're doomed, period, and another is full of cruel optimism, pretending that everything will be just fine, those two people will end up doing exactly the same thing. Nothing. Both mentalities will turn our spaceship into a flying torch. Or, more precisely, our spaceship will actually be fine. You don't actually need to worry about saving the Earth. It can go right on without us. But the astronauts on board, they're gonna get cooked. Us right along with other animals. Maybe the only thing that will survive is this guy. That's called a blobfish, and they live so deep beneath the ocean surface that other fish would have their insides pushed out through their mouths from the pressure. Kind of amazing, huh? Anyway, if someone's telling you either that it's all over for us, it's Mad Max time, or that the mad scientists like this guy, or the nutjob English professors, are all wacko, you need to go and find someone else who says, it's gonna be hard, but we can change. I mean, you're talking about a species that used to take seriously the divine right of kings. Here are the facts. We've put enough greenhouse gases in the atmosphere now that it's going to take a lot. It's going to get significantly worse, no matter what, and many of them are still gonna be there hundreds of years from now. Perfectly tuned Earth is over. But we can still keep from turning hothouse Earth into total hellscape. But before I go further on the science, here's a pretty massive counterintuitive. Knowledge of the facts about our climate situation is a completely insignificant predictor of people's actions. There are lots of these kinds of studies coming from our friends in psychology and the social sciences and communication, and they're very much onto something. They look at our response to COVID-19 and show us it really wasn't the objective facts we used to make decisions. They look at climate understanding and show that stories matter more than just more information. So if I hadn't learned from them, I could be like these poor COVID researchers, assuming that just the facts, ma'am, will ever be enough. Indeed, I could spend the rest of this talk just reviewing data and not get very far. I could show you more animations about how many degrees the world has warmed, especially at the poles. And I could show you umpteen satellite images revealing how much ice has disappeared from the Arctic. Basically, we've lost about half of it in under half a century, and it's super hard to turn that freezer back on again. So it'd be really good to reverse this pattern soon. I could walk you through umpteen graphs showing humanity's greenhouse gas emissions in the last 1,000 years, and how exactly that hard upward spike at the end maps onto the rise in temperatures we're seeing. I could even give you the unintimidating versions with no numbers at all, hardly. There's the carbon emissions increase there, and there's the temperature increase. But no matter what, we'd end up back here. The tall stripes to the left of the We Are Here tab use a color for each year and represent 1850 to the present. Bluer colors are cooler because, well, we like that color. And those temperatures are cooler than average. Redder ones are hotter. There are many middle pathways between the two extremes represented here, and that 9-degree one is extreme. But scientists have warned we were headed toward that upper right path far more than the lower one. And it's only been recently, with long-delayed steps like the Inflation Reduction Act, that we can say we're starting to bend back toward the bottom. If that makes you sit back with a big sigh of relief, though, two things. One, this is a hell of an experiment that we're running on our only livable habitat. And we're edging very close to tipping points and cascading systems that are very difficult to project beyond. Antarctic glaciers cutting loose and sliding into the sea, melting permafrost in the Arctic, loosing new methane emissions in a vicious feedback loop. We don't know exactly how things could go here. Such developments could send us flying violently back toward that upper path. Newsflash, most scientists tend to estimate conservatively. They really don't want to be called Chicken Little. Two, the lower pathway toward only a 1.5 degrees Celsius average rise is looking extremely unlikely. We're already at 1.2 now, and our path remains pointed well upwards of 2 degrees. And this is going to mean some really awful hardships. Look closely. The best case scenario still has a lot more orange and red in the next couple decades than we've experienced so far. Are you feeling somber yet? Well, you can see that if I just kept going on this way, many people would just walk away, shaking their heads. Maybe they'd be moody for a little while, but they'd move on. Oh, well. And this is exactly what's been happening for decades now. The facts aren't enough to change things. Don't get me wrong, we need them. Quality data is empowering, but only if you have an idea of what to do with it, only if you feel part of a story worth fighting for. The facts and the stories need each other, but for far too long, we've hit people over the head with data and nothing to make them care. Except maybe a bunch of really sad polar bears, plus Al Gore showing up with another edition of An Inconvenient Truth. So this is what I'm saying. We need to inhale and breathe out stories of rational, defiant hope. And for the rest of this lecture as TV show, that's what's coming. Real barriers and plausible solutions. Some very good news is that the vast majority of people want those in power to confront reality. We've been misled by clever public relations experts working for the uber wealthy in the fossil fuel industry. We fail to imagine just how many other people desperately care about a livable future. Turns out most Americans, contra what you might think from watching all of our politicians, actually want a lot more clean energy investment, not more fossil fuel subsidies that mask the cost of gas at the pump. In fact, the groups of Americans who are alarmed or at least seriously concerned about our life support system are growing very rapidly. Those were the numbers just 6 years ago, and now the number in the appropriately alarmed camp has nearly tripled. The vast majority of people are waking up slowly but surely. But of course, the bad news is that the vast majority of people aren't in charge. Instead, sometimes it feels like our leaders are rooting for the wrong side in Star Wars.
This fierce machine which you have built, upon which we stand, will bring an end to the Senate, to their cherished fleet. All remaining systems will bow to the First Order and will remember this as the last day of the Republic.
Okay. Anyway, the problem remains. The climate care most people want is barely starting to become actual policy. It took absurd compromise to agree to a bill a fraction the size it should have been. It's not rocket science here, folks. The reason is pretty simple, and it's not as dramatic as stormtroopers either. It's the same greed at work, though. Here are Senator Joe Manchin's earnings, just from his own coal company, over the last 10 years. And that's to say nothing of the millions in campaign donations from fossil fuel companies that he also received. It doesn't matter who you ask. The man is as covered with special interest dirt and lobbying cash as politicians come. But here's my point. It's good storytelling that's exposing these patterns. Some is investigative journalism, some is art, some is social media. People are onto these knuckleheads. They're seeing through greenwashing, the current strategy of choice for fossil fuel barons, telling us they're finally serious about climate, but spending a pittance on clean energy. Telling us they're green now, but spending millions per day in extracting new crude that we can't even begin to afford to burn. Giving us sunshine with carefully cast representatives, pretending there's something clean or natural about the chemicals and pressure levels they use in fracking. Meanwhile, big oil keeps promising to fix everything with carbon capture technologies that might exist someday, but definitely don't yet and may never. And they're spending millions sponsoring reports about these pipe dreams, making sure we know there's a big techno fix coming, so we don't actually need to change any of our habits. Basically, they're selling snake oil.
Job done. I just planted a tree while wearing a hard hat. You see, here at Snake Oil, we're doing our bit. The same way we might kiss you on the forehead while choking you to death. We're putting the con back in conscience, as the majority of our marketing features green energy, while the minority of our investments employ it. But look, we know what bikes are.
Now gaze upon these crisp video clips of renewable energy sources, proving once and for all that we are investing heavily in stock footage.
Oh, we're also planning to invest in carbon capture technology that we just sort of hope will exist one day. Which is why we're also planning to invest in magic wands, genie lamps, and wishing wells.
You see, we're just like you. You love 80s nostalgia? We do too, because that's when we knew about climate change, but didn't have to do anything about it. Good times.
I know you're worried about climate change, but you can take my word for it. We will be okay. We will be okay. You're f***ed. We just posted record profits. You just moved into your mom's shed. Let's just hope her love is renewable.
Snake oil. Well, oil be damned.
I like exploration and discovery. Pure scientific research in space, as well as all kinds of life-saving medical applications, it enables years later, sometimes, like messenger RNA-based COVID vaccines. Have you really stopped to think about how amazing it is that in just a year or two, our scientists around the world were able to work together to produce vaccines that essentially are biotech body mods for us? And let us be in person with each other today. I even feel like, you know, whatever the heck this guy is doing, it's pretty cool too. One of my kids just said they wish they could fly, and he has figured it out. But the wealth behind all that tech wants no part of a world without its one ring of power, fossil fuels. So it insists on dominating our imaginations. Most people know, theoretically, that there's a large wealth gap in America and many other developed nations, but I'm saying this is directly responsible for the sabotage of our spaceship.
Here is the actual distribution of wealth in America. The poorest Americans don't even register. They're down to pocket change, and the middle class is barely distinguishable from the poor. In fact, even the rich between the top 10 and 20 percentile are worse off. Only the top 10% are better off. And how much better off? So much better off that the top 2 to 5% are actually off the chart at this scale. And the top 1%? This guy? Well, his stack of money stretches 10 times higher than we can show. Here's his stack of cash, restacked, all by itself. This is the top 1% we've been hearing so much about. So much green in his pockets that I have to give him a whole new column of his own, because he won't fit on my chart. 1% of America has 40% of all the nation's wealth. The bottom 80%, 8 out of every 10 people, or 80 out of these 100, only has 7% between them. And this has only gotten worse in the last 20 to 30 years.
Yeah, and in fact, that gap has grown even further in the decades since that video was made. In fact, just last week, a new Congressional Budget Office report came out with the breathtaking data that the bottom half of Americans now have only 2% of the nation's wealth. Given these disparities, it shouldn't be surprising that there are some, like that 1% guy, who think they can escape the consequences of destroying our habitat. That's privilege. It's not enough for these people to have multi-million dollar homes above ground. They need a tunnel to the one below with their apocalyptic escape bunker and the swimming pool. But that's not you or me. That's just three men who together have more wealth than half of our country. Here's our greater danger. If you think you can afford to tackle this individually, that's delusion. Here's how I know. Not just because of the facts that science uncovers, not just because of those mediated by nonfiction, but because of truthful fictions. The stories that take me places I can't go through direct experience. Let me show you one that takes despair very seriously, for instance. Keep in mind, I was diagnosed with depression two decades ago now, but much as I'm tempted, I've never tried to go it alone like Michael does in this scene, taking all the weight of climate destruction onto his own shoulders and deciding that the end is written in stone.
I mean, Reverend, the world is changing so fast and right in front of us. I mean, 1/3 of the natural world has been destroyed in your lifetime. You know, the Earth's temperature will be 3 degrees centigrade higher. 4 is the threshold. You know, severe, widespread, and irreversible impacts. And when scientists say stuff like that, National Center for Atmospheric Research, Lawrence Livermore, Potsdam Institute, Reverend...
He went on like that for some time. By 2050, sea levels 2 feet higher on the East Coast. Low-lying areas underwater across the world. Bangladesh, 20% loss of landmass. Central Africa, 50% reduction in crops due to drought. The Western reservoirs dried up, climate change, refugees, epidemics, extreme weather.
You know, the bad times, they will begin, and from that point, everything moves very quickly.
This is heavy stuff. Michael goes on to ask his pastor how humanity can be forgiven, and because he doesn't get a convincing answer, he kills himself. The film demonstrates very powerfully and painfully that the only way to confront our climate demons honestly and fully is with deep community. What Michael needs and doesn't get is a better story to be part of, one that fits the facts. But for us, witnessing a story like his can help us immensely in working through our own anger, our own grief, as we face these situations and turn them toward action. Let me give you a happier example now. I'm going to show you a scene from a little-known film made in Iceland and Ukraine just a few years before Russia invaded. In Woman at War, Hala is running from the authorities. She's just committed an act of nonviolent resistance, something that doesn't hurt anyone directly, but temporarily shuts down a Chinese aluminum smelting corporation that has set up shop in Iceland, one of the world's most ecologically responsible nations. She doesn't want her country going backward, so she's following in the footsteps of her heroes, Mahatma Gandhi and Nelson Mandela. But now she's forced to ask a stranger for immediate help.
Sigh. Ef þú getur hugsað að hjálpa mér, þá verður það að gerast núna. Þeir eru að leita mér.
Og hvað hefur þú gert að þér?
Ég sló út háspennulínurnar.
Já, svo það ert þá þú?
Já.
Þetta er þá í fimmta skipti. Mm-hmm. Og hvað ert þú einaverki?
Já.
Og þú vilt gera mig meðsekan í vandalisma?
Ég ekki glæpamaður. Ég að reyna að stöðva glæpi og skemmdarverk gegn okkur
öllum. Og hverra manna ert þú?
Ég heiti Halla. Dóttir Benedikt Þjóðssonar. Amma mín hérna úr Brimstungunni.
Já, já, já. Svo þú ert af Eivíkur kyninu. Já, já, ég þekki þitt fólk. Og þú ert dóttir hans Bensa, já.
Það sem ég hef gert, trúi ég af öllu hjarta að sé rétt.
This is just one time we see how Hala's fight for environmental justice can only succeed through real kinship. This man takes a huge risk to help her because of how his backstory matches hers, despite having been complete strangers literally 1 minute earlier. I love this low-budget film, particularly for its constant reminders that battling for the good of everyone, even those who arrest you, depends on constant reminders of what one's fighting for, not just against. In this film, that is the majesty of glaciers, the beauty of moss blankets on lava fields, and the immersive pleasures of hot springs. It's also the joys of musical harmony with other human beings, including those growing up behind us, children with whom we make art, whose hands we hold, and help forward into an increasingly dangerous and difficult future. It's also crucial to ponder stories that emphasize real and available solutions, not just the problems. The rapidly expanding library of climate stories out there are increasingly in active conversation with emergent solutions. While some are dedicated to exposing the lies that have delayed climate action, others put flesh on and extrapolate from steps being taken daily by engineers, farmers, city planners, and international aid workers. These tales are both reflecting and inspiring work like that of nonprofits such as Project Drawdown, which works to identify, measure, and otherwise cultivate a wide range of practical strategies to reduce our greenhouse gas emissions. Some of my favorite lesser-known investments that they emphasize include alternative refrigerants, concentrated solar, green and cool roofs like ours here at WIU QC, microgrids, silvopasture, and walkable cities. But what they all point at together is ultimately a fairly straightforward, if immense, life support system equation. We have to figure out, how do we put fewer heat-trapping gases into our air, and how do we expand the sinks that our ship relies on to filter them out? One last point. Whatever media and genres you enjoy, climate stories are out there for you, waiting to be read, watched, played, and indeed created. They come in every form. Door-stopping novels like Richard Powers' Pulitzer Prize-winning The Overstory, which narrates human stories alongside those of often far longer citizens of our planet, our tree brethren. And Kim Stanley Robinson's The Ministry for the Future, which imagines a heat wave that's bad enough that India starts sending particulates into the atmosphere in a temporary bid to cool things down. If you're into creative nonfiction, let me recommend Saving Us by Catherine Hayhoe, a rare hybrid of a climate scientist and pastor's wife, whom you met earlier when she read some of her emails. And All We Can Save is my current favorite collection of essays about our climatological long emergency. Enjoy young adult novels? I do. Dry wonders what Southern California might turn into when the Colorado River finally taps out, while Rage as a Wolf lets its protagonist walk away from high school for self-taught unschooling, which turns out to have plenty to do with climate. Comics matter too, folks. Two of my favorite recent works are those of journalism and memoir. one set among indigenous peoples of the Northwest Territory and the other following a recent college grad whose strategy for paying off her enormous loans is to work in the tar sands of Alberta. She can't stop coughing, but she also can't walk away from the incredible cash flow. I've mentioned a lot of movies today, but two more. As Beasts of the Southern Wild reveals, the future has arrived. It's just unevenly distributed. Environmental justice is all about recognizing that we have human canaries in very literal coal miles on our planet, people who enjoy fewer layers of insulation against climate impacts. Mother is an absolute scream of a movie, moving deftly between domestic realism and outrageous horror. It's part art house film, part Hollywood spectacle, and certain to provoke. Rather watch a season of television? You won't find better than Station 11, an HBO miniseries about the aftermath and the weird temporal feelings created by a devastating pandemic. You might think, I thought these were climate stories, Dr. Hamner, but guess why the number and severity of pandemics is likely to keep increasing in the 21st century? Because of increased proximity among species that have never lived near each other, but now are, due in major part to climate-related migrations. And finally, a quick shout out to video games. Among the dozen or so climate games I've explored, the standouts include Horizon Zero Dawn and its sequel, which look back at our era of climate destruction with the eye of an anthropologist. As I conclude, let me do a very quick review of current events. In the last month alone, we've seen a third of Pakistan go underwater with flooding that won't recede quickly, resulting in flies and disease and millions of displaced people. There have been more numerous and rapidly moving wildfires in California and the Pacific Northwest, enormous hurricanes hitting Florida and even Canada. That didn't used to happen ever. And they've dumped more water and twisted harder due to warmer waters that are due to greenhouse gas emissions. And here in the Quad Cities, while the last month has been fine, we've had so-called 100-year floods in 2001, 2004, 2008, 2014, and 2019. Maybe some of you parked near this spot. The Mississippi River came up to our door, higher even than this picture shows, just 3 years ago. And I know I don't want to use River Drive when it looks like that. Of course, floods, fires, and hurricanes happen without human beings around. But what we're doing in warming our climate is a massive threat multiplier. By twisting the dials in the control room, we've been amplifying these disasters' severity and frequency. And if we're going to deal with the consequences and right the ship, we'll need a lot more sense of global and local community, not polarization and isolation. There are actually a ton of great partial solutions out there. Steps we can take with existing technology that are orders of magnitude less expensive than letting our life support systems erode. One last comment. I hope you've noticed today how the story I've told depends on experts and disciplines across the arts and sciences. A liberal arts education is not some flowery bow on top of a university, something to invest in when you have a little spare time or money. The arts and sciences are the foundations with which we determine the most crucial problems for our society to attack. The intellectual spaces that imagine what do justice and freedom really look like, so we'll know and recognize them when we see them. My hope is that you come away a little more likely to value stories alongside facts, words with numbers, emotions in tune with knowledge. Being aboard this ship together means we need to choose our stories wisely. Or perhaps we must acknowledge with Gandalf that we wouldn't necessarily choose the story we're living in some ways, yet we can still seize his advice to Frodo. It's all about what we do with the time that we have. But you didn't think I was going to go out with something warm and fuzzy, did you? Just because I gave my kids middle names from The Lord of the Rings? Since my whole aim today has been to encourage us to choose our stories wisely, let's end with a very, very short film about that giant baby I showed you earlier. I hope we can reimagine what it means to live well on this spaceship. And that means confronting the ideology of endless growth and fossil fuel addiction.
Congratulations, your baby has shown impressive growth since last quarter.
But doctor, our child is already the size of a small truck.
We're up to 97 gallons of formula a day.
You should be very proud.
We need a forklift to change diapers.
For God's sake, when will it stop?
Oh. Stop growing? Your baby?
We just want our child to be happy and healthy, not—
Silence. Growth is good. Babies must grow. Always grow. Line go up. Only horrible parents think a baby shouldn't grow.
Touch nice. Touch nice.
All right, that is our show, everyone. Hope you have a great decade ahead. We are out, but stay tuned for Q&A. Good night.